Well, we're fortunate this afternoon to have two veterans from North Africa with us today. They were adversaries who obviously didn't know each other at the time. I will say that the three of us together are 241 years old. I'm the only one who looks it. I'll introduce them separately first, and then I'll get it started by asking questions. But then we'll open it up, and hopefully you will have good questions of the two of them. I think you'll find that they've both had extraordinary lives and both have extraordinary experiences in North Africa. We'll try and keep it focused to some degree on North Africa today, since that's the focus of this part of the conference. On my right, initially, Walt Ehlers was born in Kansas in 1921 into a farm family. He joined the Army in 1940 at age 19 with his older brother, Roland. He made his first assault landing in North Africa at the age of 21 with the 3rd Infantry Division in Morocco. He made his second assault landing on Sicily at the age of 22 and his third at age 23 as a staff sergeant in the 18th Infantry of the 1st Infantry Division at Omaha Beach in Normandy. On that day, at Omaha Beach, Roland Ehlers was killed. Staff Sergeant Ehlers, who was not killed, fought in other battles with the 1st Division, including the Hurtgen Force. He was promoted to 2nd Lieutenant, and in December 1944, he was awarded the Medal of Honor for gallantry at Normandy. On Walt's 24th birthday, the Germans, who obviously knew what they were up against, which was May 7, 1945, the German High Command surrendered. Walt subsequently worked for the Veterans Administration for 29 years and another 8 years for disabled American veterans. His awards also include 3 Purple Hearts. Gerhard Hennis, on my left, was born in Germany in 1922. And his family subsequently moved to Koblenz. His father was a minister. Gerhard was an exchange student in England before the war.
Canterbury.
In March of 1939, Gerhard became a labor camp worker, an Arbeitsmann. And among other things, he helped to reinforce the Westfall, the Siegfried Line, as it was known to the Western Allies. Those who were working on it were told that it was to protect Germany from French invasion. In December 1939, 3 months after World War II began, Gerhard joined a Signal Corps battalion in Posen, in Poland, eventually rising to the rank of lieutenant. He subsequently was transferred to France, and then to North Africa in 1941, where he was a signal officer with the Afrika Korps. He participated in various battles of the North African campaign, including El Alamein and the retreat west into Tunisia. He was captured by the British in May of 1943, eventually to American custody, and spent the next several years in various prisoner of war camps, including one in Tennessee. After being repatriated to Germany, he returned to the United States in 1953 and became a citizen of this country several years later. He worked for church organizations for nearly 50 years, working and traveling in 80 countries, including 6 years of living in Geneva with the World Council of Churches. Please join me in welcoming these two veterans. So, Gerhard, let me start with you first, because you were in Africa first. As a soldier, you served in Poland and in France. Tell us about arriving in North Africa to join the signal unit. Your job, essentially, was to lay wire behind advancing infantry and armor units. What were the circumstances like at that point? How well equipped were you? What did you find when you got there?
The purpose of the Signal Corps, I was at the Army level, you had different kinds of units, was to lay cable. There were two kinds of cable. One was field cable, very thin. You could lay it for about 40 miles. And the earth was the reverse flow for that connection. And you had a heavier rubber cable where the reverse flow was again in the cable, and that had maybe a capacity of some 10 miles. So I was a wire stringer in North Africa, and I was serving at the army level. But for reasons unknown, I always was kind of up front. And I ran on mines three times and lived. And got into all kinds of other scraps and was rather fortunate. And then I had myself taken a prisoner, not by the British, but by the French. And that was a special experience. I will explain later if asked.
Okay, Gerhard, why was it a special experience?
You know what? His memory is short. Well, three of us thought that we would do what all soldiers in war are commanded to do, to rejoin their units. And so the three of us wanted to make it to Spanish Morocco, 800 miles away. But after a short week, we were caught again and turned over to the French in the same camp in Tunisia. And we got sentenced to 30 days at bread and water. And I mean bread and water. And so after 3 days, they made a little cage near the latrine for good measure, barbed wire. They put us in that 9 by 9 foot cage. When one evening a French first lieutenant was coming toward our cage, and he had in his hand a piece of bread. And he said in pidgin German, the French can't pronounce the H in the alphabet. The French are limited in some ways. And he said, ear, hear, piece of bread, wife of farmer, he had been a prisoner of war in Germany, gave me extra piece of bread. Ear, here it is. Do not want to owe you anything. And then he walked away, kind of raising his shoulders as if he had gotten rid of a load that he had to get rid of. The Free French did not particularly care for the Germans and vice versa. Am I too wrong?
No, that was perfect. So, Walt, you were on a ship heading across the Atlantic with your brother.
Yes.
And they distributed French language dictionaries to you. And
that's right.
Did you know that they spoke French in Morocco? Did you know you were going to Morocco?
No, I was kind of naive in those days. So when they gave us the French translation books, naturally we thought we were going to France. But I found out there was another country that was speaking French. And I was pretty doggone seasick when I was on that ship, and I didn't care much about where I was going, just so I could get off of that ship.
So describe to us arriving off the coast of Morocco. The weather, as I mentioned this morning, was very bad initially, and then it calmed down for the 8th of November. You landed at Fidala with the 3rd Division near Casablanca.
That's right.
Tell us about it.
Well, I landed with the 3rd Infantry Division in Africa, and it was indefinitely a strange situation. Number one, like I said, I was so seasick when they put me on this Higgins boat, I even got sicker. And the French were shelling us from Casablanca, and they were coming right over to Fidala, and the shells were just, we were out in these boats, Higgins boats, between the mothership and the Higgins boats and the beach, and we were headed for the beach. And the shells were going right over there, my head, and I felt like I wanted to raise up my head and have it blown off so I could get out of my misery. Well, I wasn't thinking about the consequences. But when I got off, I was on one of these rounded, pointed Higgins boats. You know, they had different kinds of boats. Everybody thinks all Higgins boats got a flat thing you run out the front. They didn't for the first two landings that I made. So I had to jump over the side into the water and then run up on the beach. The first thing I saw on the beach was one of our men who had gotten hit, and his right thigh was bent right straight out from him. And I looked at him, and he was laying on his face, and he apparently was dead. But I had to keep on going anyway, and I got up into the rocks and things like this. We got shelled a little bit more, and we kept on going, and we finally took over the French Morocco part there and captured Casablanca. And that was, there's a lot of story here, but I'll just let you take it.
That's good. Well, and then you and your brother were both transferred to the 1st Division.
Yes.
But tell first the fascinating story. In January of 1943, yeah, you had special visitors who came to Casablanca, the president and the prime minister, yeah, and you were in the battalion that was part of the honor guard for President Roosevelt.
I was in the 18th Infantry Company K, and we were selected as the front row of the honor guard for President Roosevelt when he arrived. And of course, when President Roosevelt's coming down the street, and he's about from here to you, from me, and I heard him say, "These are mighty fine looking troops. They make good replacements for the 1st Infantry Division." I thought, wow. Well, within 3 weeks, we were on our way to the 1st Infantry Division. When we got to the 1st Infantry Division, it was the 18th Infantry Regiment, Company K, and it's kind of strange taking regular Army men who went into the military service and had 2 years of combat training, and then send them out of your division to another division. But it was by the order of President Roosevelt. And so I went on an executive order. I've been on a lot of those since then, but it's amazing what can happen to you when you speak to the wrong people. And when we got to 18th Infantry Regiment, we joined the English Army. You can imagine, the first thing I noticed that I didn't like about that, we had oxtail soup. And when I opened my soup can, I was looking for the tail. Sure enough, I found a hair in the soup and I wouldn't eat it. So anyway, that's my experience of getting into Africa. Oh, by the way, and getting into Africa, I thought I went back 500 years. I went out into the field there, and I saw these Arabs out there plowing the field. They had a wooden plow, and they were plowing the dirt, and it was only going about that deep, you know. And, you know, in Kansas, we have plows that plow 6 inches of 8 inches of dirt, and turn it over, you know. But out there, they were just very scraping and planting on the ground and all that stuff. Unbelievable. We couldn't believe we were going back that far and wondering what the heck we were doing there. It's a very strange world, and to compare to what we came from. And there were no automobiles. And the automobiles that they did have ran on some kind of a stinking dish vegetable oil or something like that. I don't know what it was, but they smelled a high. And when you saw one of those buses, they would be loaded with people all over them. And that was the only transportation they had over there. It was unbelievable how far behind that country was. And if you went to Casablanca today, you would see something different.
That's right.
Yeah. So, Gerhard, you arrive, and you're part of Tobruk, and then you're at Alamein. You experienced the agony and the ecstasy of that army that was in North Africa at the time for the Germans. Tell us a little bit about the experience of retreating across Africa once Alamein had occurred. And within that context, what did you all think about Rommel? How did Rommel seem to from the vantage point of a young lieutenant? He had beguiled the Allies to some extent by that point. Did he beguile his own soldiers?
Retreat is different from advance. The preoccupation, at least in my own mind, after retreating from El Alamein was, how in the world am I going to get out of Africa? Then I was preoccupied because my assignment was, my platoon and I, with the retreating German troops last night to destroy the telephone wires. And that was tricky business because the roads were being mined. Indeed, the mine pots, the British mines, were near the telephone posts. And one night, when we were destroying the cable, 3 o'clock, a command car comes toward us, a general jumps out. I saw it, he said. I saw it. You turned on the light. I had given specific instructions not to turn on the light. I said, General, I'm trying to find the things that we need to destroy, and I need to turn the light. I saw it. You will hear from me. Well, I got a letter of reprimand on which my company commander never acted. So we continued to saw every night, something like 600 miles. We destroyed the telephone lines, which did not really hinder the British advancing. Our work was for naught. But it was interesting. Beautiful moonlit nights, Africa, man. And occasionally there were strafing planes and we didn't care for them. But our platoon managed to get a near kill which was acknowledged, for which the man who worked the machine gun got the Iron Cross second class.
And how about Rommel's reputation from your vantage point at that time?
Like all generals, it's good to stay away from him.
You and Colonel Cirillo would get along well.
Well, he is a ranking officer also. I'm kidding. I only saw him once from a great distance. He was generally popular with the troops. 1941, Tobruk being besieged, he comes up to the front troops. How's it going, men? Not good, General. We don't have any water. We don't have any transport. We don't have enough ammunition. He said, look over there. You see the barbed wire? You see that hill position there in Tobruk? He said, get it. We didn't get it until a year later. And that probably the taking of Tobruk in 1942, certainly for me, was the most glorious experience ever. Moving across the tank ditch, laying out our cable, ever forward, 33,000 prisoners of war, and about 100 gathered around my tent. So we had to watch the prisoners of war instead of laying wires.
And one of the great disasters for the British Army in all of World War II.
Correct.
So, Walt, you arrived to join the 18th Infantry in time for the Battle of El Guitar. You were there.
Yes, I was.
And El Guitar was an attack by the 10th Panzer Division in the spring of 1942, at a time when the battles of Kasserine Pass were over. The Germans were trying essentially to stave off the strangulation of their lines as the army with Gerhard is pulling back from Libya into Tunisia. Describe for us what you found there. It was one of the most intense bits of combat in the North African campaign. And as I asked Gerhard about Rommel, your commanders in the 1st Division were a couple of pretty famous guys, Major General Terry De La Mesa Allen, and the Assistant Division Commander was Ted Roosevelt. Did you have any contact with them?
Not personally. not personally.
Tell us about Qatar.
I saw them, but actually they didn't operate down at our level because it's too dangerous. we were. What I would like to tell you is that when we were up in North Africa, and we were supposed to be heading out towards the Mediterranean. And we're just one day they came out and they told us we had to go over here and protect a pass of this valley that we were in. And so Company K was assigned to a hill. They gave it a number, and I don't know what the number was, but I always hear about them after I have fought on them. And so I don't know sometimes what hill I was on. But anyway, when I was leaving there, I'm going to have one of these lapses of memories, you know, you get at 91. It's kind of hard to keep your concentration going here. Can you hear me okay? Oh, okay. Well, anyway, I'll get on the story here. We were hiking out across there. We came on all these hills here, and every time we came one, they said, well, you're going to see the Mediterranean on the other side. And that's what the hardest part about Africa that we had was going over those hills. But when we got to El Guitar, that was another story. We headed up to this mountain on the side over there, and it had a kind of like of a pass through there. And so we went up on this hill over here on the left side, and all the rest of the division was down across the front and down over on the right side. And so I'm with the 18th Infantry, Company K then, and we were the first company that got a presidential unit citation. We fought all day on, I forgot what the number of the day was, but it was a heck of a long day, and we were running out of ammunition, and so that night we withdrew off of the hill, and we were getting our supplies caught up with us, and so we were getting more ammunition, things like this, and during the night the Germans made one last assault on that hill. They came up there, they shot up a bunch of flares and things, and we saw them running all over there, and they couldn't find any of us. And so they withdrew off of the hill. The next morning, they were withdrawing because they had ran out of fuel, or running out of fuel, because they couldn't get to our fuel depots. That's what their original plan was, to get behind our troops and get into our fuel depot. And but they didn't make it off of that hill. We killed over 200 Germans on that hill that day. And they kept coming up the hill in half tracks, dumping them off and going back, the half tracks that survived and so forth. And speaking of half tracks, we had one of our own half tracks sitting over there, and they shot one of their 88s at it. It blew it right in two. I saw this half track get blown in two. I saw a man get blown in two up there at the same time. And it's a gruesome sight. But I'll tell you one thing. The Germans put up a hard fight on that hill, and they had two panzer divisions. And the 1st Infantry Division didn't have our tanks up there yet. We were just hanging on there all by ourselves. And the division's artillery were firing the 105 howitzers and the 155 howitzers. And they had the long tom 155 howitzers out there. And they had all these pointed up this valley. Well, the Germans were coming down there, and man, you could see the firepower going out there. And we wondered how they were ever going to get through. Well, they didn't, but they got stopped. But, you know, our front line, our artillery, was already spiking their guns because they were figured they were going to have to withdraw. But the Germans withdrew that night because they figured they couldn't get through the line. They didn't know how close they come getting through. But anyway, they didn't get through, and we survived that day. And it was the longest, one of the longest days of my life. And I mean, when you're fighting, and you have to do this firing for 8 hours in a spell, that is tough. And but we survived it. And when we came back up on the hill that morning, the Germans were leaving, and we could see them leaving up and going up the valley. And that's when we started chasing them back to the Mediterranean. But again, here we are. We're going up these hills, and every hill we come to, they'd say, "The Mediterranean's just over the hill." We went over a few hills before we got to the Mediterranean. and then we ended out in the desert.
And you were a mortarman.
I was a mortarman then.
And you ran out of mortar ammunition, isn't that right?
But I had to, I ran out of mortar ammunition. I had to take up the rifle, and I was on the front line there. And by the way, talk about friendly fire. It was the first time that I heard about friendly fire. And I also saw it. Our artillery down there was getting directions from the artillery foreman, the man who's the forward observer. Yeah. Anyway, he was given the position of the Germans who were attacking the hill. And so he called in that position, but he got it in reverse. He got our position first, and then I gave the German positions as ours. But and I saw these artillery guns. I saw smoke coming up from it, and all of a sudden we were getting blasts. And I'm right out there on front because we were already running out of ammunition. And a big old artillery shell, one of ours, landed right close to me, and I went up into the air, and I came down. And when the artillery's barrage stopped, we got it stopped by emergency flags and things like that. And I was laying there, and I felt something hot beside me. There was a piece of shrapnel as big as my forearm here, laying right there next to me. That's how close it came that day. Like I said, it was a long day.
So, Gerhard, I'll ask you one more question, then we'll open it up to the audience. The day he's talking about, which is late March of 1943. First of all, did you have any recollection of that battle, El Guitar? I know that you were part of the Kasserine Pass sequence of battles. Tell us what you recall about that. That would have been a little more than a month earlier than the date Walt was just talking about.
I had a regiment commander who had been my battalion commander in France. I didn't like him then. I didn't like him later on when he asked me to get away from laying cables, doing dangerous, important stuff, and made me his aide-de-camp, or whatever the French call it. I didn't like that because he smoked a lot of cigarettes and wanted me to be his companion during the night when he made all these Signal Corps charts every night, except that he was always 24 hours late. So I didn't like that assignment, so I do not know anything about the Western attack by the first Italian army by then, and I didn't know anything about Kasserine, other than that I know it's one of those steep, bald passes that are common in Tunisia. So I can't answer the question because the colonel kept me busy with stupid stuff.
Colonel,
speaking of the Italians, yeah, we fought the Italians too, by the way, and but we found out that they're much more easier to fight than the Germans, and the Italians were ready to give up. They didn't want to fight that war, and so we captured a lot of Italians before we got through there. But it was, I guess, that was the most people we captured because we didn't find too many German soldiers in that vicinity at that time, but there were Italian outposts and things like this that we captured, and they were ready to give up.
So Walt, if I recall correctly, you began having nightmares when you began having nightmares in North Africa?
My nightmares mostly started after my brother got killed on Normandy
uh-huh,
D-Day.
Uh-huh. You would have nightmares about you and your mother fighting the Japanese together.
Oh, yes. You know, this is a nice coincidence you might be interested in. In January of 1950, I guess it was, I was asking I called my brother and wanted him to attend Medal of Honor convention up in Indianapolis, Indiana, where they put a memorial up for us. And so I'm talking to him on the telephone, and I said, you know, Klaus, I said, I don't know if I ever told you this, but my mother and I and my brother, we, and I especially, had these nightmares where she and I and my brother were over in the Philippines or wherever they were in the Pacific, helping them fight the Japanese. And I said that, and then he said, well, Walt, he says, I was having these nightmares that my mother and I were over in Africa and in Germany. And he said, I was having these nightmares that we were fighting the Germans. I said, you know, there must be something to this. I'm not absolutely sure what it is, but, you know, my mother made me make a commitment when I went into the service. She said, I won't sign your papers for you unless you promise to be a Christian soldier. And so I told her I would be. But that really set in on me, and I just think that there's something to this fabulous community between people, I had nightmares for 50 years after I got out of the military service, having every night my brother come to visit me. And that's unbelievable, but it is what happened.
This is the brother who was killed in Normandy, right. not the other brother who was in the Pacific.
So when I was to give a speech at French Liberation Ceremony, the 50th anniversary, I mentioned that when I closed my speech, that my brother was killed on Normandy on D-Day. And, you know, not to, since that time, I've had hard, very few nightmares about him coming to visit me. But every once in a while, it still happens. But it's all gone now, mostly. Mm-hmm. And so there's something true about talking this thing over about with your friends or relatives or somebody else, you know.
Well, that's right. And you spent 29 years with the Veterans Administration helping them talk it through.
Yeah, well, I was telling them what to do.
So let's take some questions from the audience and see what they want to ask you about. Right here, sir. Hang on. Wait for the microphone.
Into the mic. Yeah. Gerhard. This is maybe a loaded question. I understand that you were
I'm sure it is.
I understand that you were in the POW camp at El Alamein.
Wrong. I was taken a prisoner in Tunisia.
So how did you get out?
I didn't get out. I was shipped through 16 camps in 6 different countries because I was being interrogated by the British and the French. They wanted to know what I did not know. And so eventually I was turned over to the Americans after coming to this country on the Queen Mary in 1943.
Well, the reason I asked the question about the PO camp or POW camp, is that we had 100 Germans on 100 ships in tail end of 43 or 44, and they all thought you guys were coming back to POW camps in the United States, and so did we, except that some of you people, ended up hustling cargo at various Italian ports for the Italian invasion. And on my particular ship, we unloaded at Pantelleria, which is at the choke point between Italy and Tunisia.
No, I didn't hustle anything. You don't hustle as a POW.
There's a question back there, Jeremy. Hang on a minute.
Way down there.
Way in the back.
Yeah.
He's taking the microphone to him.
Yes, you said that you were part of the 1st Infantry Division, and I was wondering what the average soldiers thought of Terry Allen and his command, because afterwards, when the invasion in Sicily, and after the invasion in Sicily, he was relieved. So I was just curious as to if you had any opinion or thoughts on how the soldiers perceived Terry Allen.
Did you hear that? You wanted to know how soldiers perceived Terry Allen, since Terry Allen was relieved in Sicily. Did you have a view of Terry Allen as a commander?
You know, when it comes to the top command, I know very little about what they were doing up there. The first place is I knew we had a general by the name of Terry Allen, and we had one by the name of Roosevelt in charge of the division, but we very seldom got that close to them, so I couldn't talk about them or how they got along or anything. But, you know, I did have a talk with Eisenhower in out in Palm Springs area, Idlewild farm he was on, staying out there after he got out of the presidency of the university of some school that he was teaching at. One of the greatest men I ever met in my life. He is, and I heard this guy talking about Eisenhower today, but, you know, and I got to talk to him personally. but I've known him for many, many years. And he's probably the only person that I know. But he told me about his generals. And the only one that he actually mentioned was Patton. And I figure, you know, you guys are having a lot of fun with Patton. But Patton was an inspiration. Patton was also one of our secret weapons, because when Eisenhower gave him a job, he got it done. And the one thing that the Germans didn't want to face was Patton. And so, you know, Terry Allen and Roosevelt had a problem because their GIs, when they got a break in Tunisia after the war was over there, and got into a fight in the city or something like that. And so Patton was trying to get them dismissed or something. I don't know what was happening, but Eisenhower broke that all up, you know. And so Eisenhower is a fantastic fantastic soldier. He knew his job, and he did a fantastic job of keeping the armies together and kept them from fighting one another.
Well, that's exactly right. The Allen and Roosevelt were held responsible, particularly by Omar Bradley, for indiscipline within the 1st Division after the Tunisia campaign. It was a bit of a drunken mob. Right. You could confirm that or not. And Bradley was lying in wait, really, for Allen's misstep, and he was relieved after the Battle of Troina in August of 1943. Question over here, sir.
I was wondering if Gerhard could share his thoughts about when you knew you were coming to the United States to a POW camp, and any thoughts about experiences in the United States as a prisoner of war.
We came to the United States, some 20 or 30 people, landing in New York on October 12th. Which was Columbus Day, which the Germans did not celebrate. And a day later, after a night's ride on the train, we landed in Crossville, and
Tennessee,
that is. I think it's still Tennessee. Why we were trucked to that camp. My group went into camp number 4. There were 6 such. 4 were for officers. 2 were for enlisted men who cleaned the barracks and did other jobs and helped the officers, especially the majors and colonels, to keep their uniforms nice. I was fortunate, and I think it was a very rare event, that my father, who had been on the Russian front for 2 years, but then had been taken prisoner in Normandy, appeared in our camp. I had suffered an injury, a kidney stone operation in the Nashville General Hospital. But I had assumed I had been kicked playing soccer in my back. And so I was back in the camp Christmas evening, and here was my father in the same camp in Crossville. He had himself transferred from Colorado and paid for the fare because that was good business. And so here was my father. And the last year, he and I were together, but my father belonged to the large group of men. Please note women. Please note women. The large group of men who do not undress. They do not undress their soul. And so I never really came close to my father. We walked together the walkways. He sat in my English classes. I did not attend his religious services because he was a minister and an officer. And then we were discharged on the same day, January 30th, 1946, 13 years to the day after Hitler came to power. And the door, the gate would open as a POW, and I was free. The question was, free for what?
And let me follow up that, Gerhard. Your father was a member of the Nazi Party?
My father was a member of the Nazi Party as of about 1934. I was not. My mother registered my elder brother for party membership, hoping that it would advance his career as a forester after the war, and my brother stayed in Russia.
Sir, right here, in the middle.
Mr. Ellis, could you describe what happened that led you to be awarded the medal?
He wants you to talk about receiving the Medal of Honor, what you did to do it.
That's not in Africa.
It's all right. We'll make an excuse and we'll deviate from Africa for this, Walt.
But if you want me to talk about it.
We do.
I got my Medal of Honor for the 9th and 10th of June of 1944. And how it came about that I got into that kind of a position was the fact that, there's always a story that precedes something that happens. And what actually preceded this happening was that on the night of the 7th or something like that, we had a German patrol overrun our position. They shot at them when they came in, but we couldn't shoot at them if they got inside. Well, I was kind of like at the back of the area there. And my squad, by the way, my position changed from waterman to, and I was a rifleman when I landed in Normandy, and I was a squad leader. And so I had 12 men. And when this German patrol came through, they happened to run right over our position, and they went out a gate down the road. This is at night. And so company commander called for someone to take a patrol out there. My platoon leader came and told me that he wanted me to take a patrol to follow those Germans. And so I took there's four of us. We went out and we went into this road, and it was dark. You couldn't see your hand in front of you. You could see the sky above, but that's about all. And we started following them, and we could hear them. And we ran across a briefcase that one of them dropped, and we picked it up. And then we went a little ways further, and I said, well, we're going far enough. We're actually probably out about a mile and a half or something like that. And, you know, here we are out here in the middle of the night amongst strangers. We don't even know who all these people are over here on this when we leave our side of the defense line, you know. And so I took the squad back, and I didn't get a reprimand. I got a congratulation. I gave them the briefcase, and when they took it down to the CP, they opened it up, and here was the second and third lines of defenses of the German positions. So the next morning, they figured out where we were, apparently, and they wanted me to take off in this particular direction with another platoon in this field over here, and I'm over here. And so we're going across there and out in an open field, and they started firing on the troops over there. And I suddenly realized the day before I'd seen some guys get caught down by the Germans out in that field, and they were laying down there as flat as they could. and I could see the Germans hitting these guys in the butt and things like this. It was gruesome, but anyway, I rushed my men up to the hedgerow in front of me because I didn't want them to get caught down out in the field. So, and then when I got down there, there's a machine gun still firing out there, so I'm going down this hedgerow, and I started up the hedgerow where the gun was up there, and I was on this side, and there were Germans coming down this side, but I didn't know they were there until I got close to them, and I heard them. I could also smell them. But anyway, I went up on the hedgerow, and here's four guys looking at me with their pistols drawn, and I got my rifle at port arms pointed at them, and the machine gun was still going, so I didn't think about anything. I just shot the four guys because I knew I had to get up there. So I kept on going up the hedgerow, and I came out, and I shot the three guys on the machine gun nest there, and then I hear another machine gun going on up another hedgerow. So I keep going on up this hedgerow, and I came out in that corner, and I got another three guys. And I thought, my gosh, what's happening here? And there's another machine gun up there. And so I go up to the third one. And when I knocked it out, there was a clearing on the brush up there. Well, this was I went up on the top here, and here was a mortar position, two big 80-millimeter type mortars, and they had about 12 men in there. And I'm up there with, and I actually, because I ran into the first patrol, I had all my guys fix their bayonets, so I had my bayonets fixed when I got aimed up there on that hill. And I'm standing there with my bayonet pointed at them, and I asked them to haul or something like that. And I didn't say anything else. They didn't do anything but turn and started running. And because my squad started coming up, and they saw their bayonets. They didn't want to get mixed up with a bayonet fight, apparently, because they didn't have any bayonets. They just had their, and they started running. And I told the guys, I said, well, you got to shoot them, or you're going to, we got to shoot them, or you're going to fight them again. And so they did. And that day, they gave me credit for knocking out 17 Germans. Myself, but I'm not absolutely sure, but that's what they said. They gave me credit for it. So it's my squad that helped me get the Medal of Honor. But that wasn't the end of it. On the next day, we had to go up, and we were going up. This time, we go up a hedgerow. We're going right next to the hedgerow. We have some cover from one side or the other, you know. And we started getting fire from three sides. That's how far out we were extended. And the company commander told us to withdraw because we were surrounded. And I said to myself, if we turn around and go back, we're going to get shot in the back. And so I went up on this little mole out here. It was like a inchly salvage place there where they kept for cattle or something. And I went up on it, and I could see over the hedgerows, and I was had my gun, I was starting to fire, and my BAR man came up and he helped me. So he fired on the right and I fired to the left. And we've asked the squad all to return back to the hedgerow behind us, which they did. And so when they all got back, well, he and I turned to go, and exactly happened what was that I got hit in the back when I was down there. They were putting a machine gun down at the corner of the hedgerow right across from me, and I just started shooting at them. And I got hit in the back. It spun me around. And as I'm coming down, I'm at port arms, and I saw a German in the hedgerow. I shot him. And then I saw my BAR man laying up there on the ground. So I ran up, and I got him, and I carried him back. Then when I turned him over to the medic, even though I was wounded myself, it knocked me completely down because that's the reason I have on dialysis today, because of my gunshot wound. But anyway, I carried the man back. I had his left arm over my shoulder, and his right arm was hit, and his right leg was hit. He couldn't even walk. And so I carried him back to the hedgerow, turned him over to the medics, and then I got to get the BAR. So I went back up, and I got the BAR. I came back, and that's probably the reason I got the Medal of Honor. But anyway, some guy says, "What were you thinking when you went back to get that BAR?" I said, "If I was thinking, I wouldn't have went back to get it. I was just doing my job." That's exactly how I got it. I was just doing my job.
Jeremy, right in front of you.
You know, right before that action, you landed on D-Day, Omaha Beach. What were your thoughts, if you had them, when you were approaching the beach in your Higgins boat and landing on Omaha Beach?
On June 6, 1944, as you're approaching Omaha Beach, you're in the 18th Infantry, so you're the second wave.
Second wave, but I wasn't.
But you weren't. So
I didn't tell you this story, complete story.
tell them a little bit about that.
I was supposed to be in the second wave, but the first wave got pinned down, and they wanted more people on the beach immediately. So they took my squad was on. We were excess squad on the 18th Infantry Regiment's headquarters boat, and it was an LCI, and so they sent my squad over into a Higgins boat, and just the 12 of us went into a Higgins boat, and we headed into the beach. And there were other boats that were being loaded up, but ours was probably one of the first ones that hit the beach. And we go running out of the boat into all this chaos on the beach. You know, you cannot imagine what those beaches looked like as a result of the first firing on the troops coming in. They were slaughtered practically, you know, just as they came out of the boats, they died right there on the beach, you know, so many of them. And there was a Navy beach master there, and he was directing traffic, and I happened to come across him, and I said, "What direction do we go from here?" And he said, "Just follow that path." He says, "If you step to the right or left of it, you'll step on mines, and the same thing will happen to you, which you see along the mine." Well, there were bodies right and left of the mine. And we went on to the, and we got on the path, and we got up to the, and we went through two rows of wire, but there was a third row there, and it hadn't been blown. And there were two guys still there, but they were laying in a ditch, kind of, and they were being fired upon. And every time they'd move, the German snipers would fire on them. And so I said, "Well, we'll fire up in the direction that fire's coming from." So we did, and we were firing in that. And they got up to blow the wire. One guy got killed. The other one got the wire blown. And we rushed through that. That made a path just like that. You got right down this row here. And then we were going up on the hill. Well, back of the wire, they didn't have any mines, fortunately. And we got up into the trenches with the Germans, and they started running from us. And that's how my approach to the beach was. When we were coming up there, there were so many airplanes going over and so many Navy ships firing at the pillboxes and so forth. But they weren't hitting our pillboxes, and they weren't no shells landing in our fields, and we had nothing but a flat field out there, and we were still exposed to the crossfire from the German guns, and they still were firing. They weren't all knocked out, and but we did get behind a pillbox up on the hill, and we captured that pillbox from behind, and we sent four guys that we captured down to be interrogated, And as my good soldier instincts told me to do, that's what I did. And then I went on and we knocked out what we could. The rest got away while we just kept on going. And we were fighting inland into the hedgerows. And that night we had to stop because we would have been disorganized. And we finally got our company. We didn't see our company commander until the next morning. And that's when I asked about my brother. And I asked, I came across his platoon sergeant. I said, Sarge, what happened? Where's my brother? He says, he's missing in action. I knew then that he wouldn't be missing in action because he wasn't that kind of a person. He would have either been hurt, you know, hit or wounded or killed. But that's all I could do. There's nothing, I couldn't go look for him or anything like that. That was chaos down on the beach, and I couldn't go look for him. But anyway, that's what it was like when I came in there.
All right, we've got time for one more question.
Get it here in the center.
Mr. Hens, I wanted to thank you for being here with us and sharing. I wanted to ask you, were you drafted or did you volunteer for the military? And also, what were your feelings of the future of Germany's success in the war when you were in Africa?
It was the pattern in the Germany of the 30s that you would serve 2 mandatory years in the military, preceded by 6 months of also mandatory labor service for a total of 2.5 years. And it was the practice that you tried to get the military service out of the way before you went on to university study, as I intended to do. And you had a second part of that question, and I can't remember more than one.
He asked you, what were your thoughts when you were in Africa about Germany's future at that point?
We were winning the war. Indeed, into 1944, and that is perhaps understandable when you are a prisoner of war. You need to maintain the comradeship and the loyalty to your own country, just as Americans would in North Vietnam. So we remained loyal and still nourished the hope that Germany might win the war. She did not.
Please join me in thanking our veterans. Thank you.